Greetings, ladies and gentlemen. This is Interesting Ideas. I'm Stan Houston, and it is the 7th of December. It's a day to remember.
History in every century records an act that lives forevermore. We'll recall as into line we fall. Thing that happened on Hawaii shore. Let's remember Pearl Harbor as we go to meet the foe. Let's remember Pearl Harbor as we did the Alamo. We will always remember how they died for liberty. Let's remember Pearl Harbor and go on to victory.
Yes, December 7th, Pearl Harbor Day, the day that we remember Pearl Harbor. Actually, it is exactly that for many people. Not many people who are still alive, but we oftentimes think of the three significant days where anybody who was alive at that time oftentimes remembers where they were when they heard the news. Obviously, when we heard the news of 9/11, everybody can pretty much tell you how they got the news. With the assassination of John F. Kennedy, most people can remember where they were when they heard that news. And those of a past generation, there's still many, who said they remember that on that Sunday morning, usually after church, they found out that the Japanese had attacked Pearl Harbor, Hawaii, and that obviously meant, and it was made official the following Monday, that we were at war. And that song that you heard was recorded 10 days afterwards by an entertainer named Danny Kaye called Remember Pearl Harbor. And that's a little bit of what we want to do today, is remember Pearl Harbor, but remember it in a somewhat positive way, if we can do just that. I'm told that at the celebration today that the six remaining survivors of that day, they'll try and be there. Obviously, they're very aged at this time. And of course, most of the men and women who were there are long gone. For sure, of course, that was 82 years ago. I remember as a child, we talked about every once in a while, because even then, you know, still people remembered it, and flags were flown on that day, and stories, and Mikey Chase, down the block, he always reminded us that, you know, his daddy had been at Pearl Harbor. His daddy had been at Pearl Harbor. He'd been there. Well, and I don't know if that was true, but Mikey believed it was, and Mikey's daddy told him it was true, and it helped Mikey. He was very proud of his daddy because he'd been at Pearl Harbor and had fought the Japanese at the beginning of the war. Well, that was great for Mikey to have that kind of pride. So I remember back then. But for many, many years, that has been the point of celebration. And we remember that day. And obviously, the world changed significantly as the United States got involved in the Second World War. And obviously, all of the history that has followed from then. Well, my title was My Mentor Who Survived Pearl Harbor. Well, let me tell you a little bit of the story and what we're talking about. And let me frame it this way. One of the things I teach people, particularly in my coaching, and really very, very strongly in my coaching about how to be on the radio, is whatever you want to be, if you finally figure that out, you know, and that's a lot of what growing up and getting older is all about, discovering who you really want to be. And once you do, try and find people that you can admire, you can imitate, you can perhaps copy, and maybe even be fortunate enough to have them teach and train you and mentor you. Do that. Because I also found out in my performance coaching that many of the more successful men and women who I had the opportunity to work with, isn't that interesting? Most of my clients were successful people. It wasn't that they were down and out and didn't know what to do. Well, I had a number of people I worked with who were in that situation, but many of them were quite successful. They just simply wanted to be better at what they were and what they wanted to do, and they knew that proverbial lesson. What do Luciano Pavarotti and Tiger Woods have in common? That dates me. But we could update it. And the line was, well, let me tell you about them. Tiger Woods, a golfer. Luciano Pavarotti, an opera star. But they're very, very good at what they do. They love what they do. They make a ton of money at what they do. And number four, even then, they still have coaches. Actually, in Tiger Woods, he had a number of coaches. And so, in effect, that was part of my teaching. Even today, I oftentimes tell younger people, don't get the job. If you can be able to work with somebody who's really good, even though it may not be the job or the best job, see if you can do that. If you can get into a position where, and oftentimes this would be in a smaller company where you can work with somebody who's really good. The woman who basically saved my life in my cancer operation. As I was going back from years, you know, you had to go 5-6 years for checkups, I would oftentimes meet one of her young assistants or one of the young scribes who was taking notes, and I would say to them, lucky you. You probably aren't going to do this job, but you get to work with one of the finest surgeons in the world. Learn from her, you know, because she's one of the best. And yet, she has a family and young children and has this incredible, very significant career. Work with somebody who's really good at what they do. Well, one of the things I teach people particularly, because I learned from it myself, was, hey, go back and if you like radio and television, or if you like music, one of the creative arts, find someone who's good and see if you can imitate them, copy them, mimic them, learn from them. And I will still tell people, particularly in religious broadcasting or in the church and people like that, I say, you know, if you really want to be good, go back to the 1950s and listen to a man named Fulton J. Sheen, who was a bishop, who had an incredible radio program that had great ratings. And once a week, he came forward all dressed up in a bishop and with a blackboard, And he beat all of the name entertainers on his particular night in ratings, as millions of people watched in black and white Fulton J. Sheen, because he knew, oh, was he good. Hey, in the radio, Paul Harvey, Chicago. When I was growing up just outside of Chicago in a small city, I used to stay up at night because on WGN radio, clear channel, 50,000 watts through the night, there was a gentleman named Franklin McCormick who had a late night radio program from, listen to this kind of schedule, 11 o'clock at night to 5 o'clock in the morning, 5 days a week. Think about that, with music and chatter and conversation and simply helping people get through the night. So find a mentor. Now, the man that influenced me a lot was a man named Earl Nightingale, who, it turns out, you know, in effect, started to listen to him, and he had a daily radio program, you know, for our changing world. And it was inspirational and motivational, and it was the essence of personal and professional development. And then he went on from his daily radio program to do cassettes, records, yes, before that, actually do what today we would call motivational programs, inspirational, instructional programs, put them on a record. People could play them, put them in cassettes. Now they could even listen to them in their car. And then, of course, the CDs. And, of course, now you probably download it because, yes, Earl Nightingale died in 1989 after a very, 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 very successful career, and of helping and inspiring many people. But he's still alive today. I still quote from him. I still sometimes listen to him. And one of the things I remember, because I was listening to him one night, I was just couldn't. So I put the tape on rather than listening to the radio. And I remember so well, because at the same time I was saying, well, you know, maybe I'll do a little workout here. And so I turned the walking machine, you know, on slow and just kind of listened to the radio. And I remember he said, if you want to be successful in life, remember, treat every person you meet as if they were the most important person in the world. Treat everybody you meet as if they were the most important person in the world. I remember stopping the machine, sitting down and saying, oh my gosh, what if we could really do that? And hopefully it's still a part of who I am. But here I also learned this story, and he told it. Earl Nightingale, as a young man at the age of 17, joined the Marines, kind of didn't tell the truth to get in, actually rose quite quickly and made sergeant at Camp Lejeune, right here in North Carolina. But it just turns out that on December 7th, 1941, Corporal Earl Nightingale was on the watchtower guard of the USS Arizona in Pearl Harbor. December 7th, Sunday, 8:15. December 7th, 1941, on the USS Arizona, the one that blew up and went down and over 2,000 men were killed, drowned, and are still entombed in the USS Arizona. But being that he was above ship and on a tower, he got blown off his tower and landed in the water. And he survived. One of the few who survived Pearl Harbor. Obviously went home after the war and began a great career. And he took a number of risks. He made life work. But he said, one of the reasons I was successful is that I took risks. I did things that could have been tough and could have cost me. I mean, I worked my career taking risks and making changes and doing different things. And the reason I could do that is because I knew that I should have been dead. What would be there to lose if this deal doesn't work, if this venture doesn't work, if it doesn't go, we'll try again. What is there to lose? Because I should be dead, and I'm not. I'm not. I have today. I'm blessed to be here today. And that has always been with me, and I've tried to live by that. It's really hard to do sometimes. I do have a favorite line when someone sometimes says to me, "It's good to see you." I come back with a stolen line from a client and I say, "Well, you know, it's good to be seen. It's good to be here. I'm fortunate to be here." And you know what? Even though I did not survive Pearl Harbor, I can actually think back to some very, very close calls, where very easily, within maybe a second or two, I can think of a couple situations on the highway where, how did we not hit? How did we not? And I think of a number of other things where, you know, I'm graced. I am lucky to be alive. And I try and live with that realization every day. So, isn't it interesting to know that every day I'm inspired by a man who, died 34 years ago, whose life and his records and his radio programs and the things that he recorded and the things that he wrote live on after him and still make a difference in people's lives. Maybe there's a lesson in that for you. Maybe you should start telling stories and doing programs and doing teaching of good and wonderful things that you know, wisdom, insight, and truth that you have. And maybe you ought to get in front of your own golden microphone and perhaps start sharing some of your wisdom, some of your stories that might someday, long after you are put away, that your wisdom lives on, your legacy lives on, your story lives on. And that, as I say, gives you just a touch of immortality. I'm Stan Houston. My company is What It Takes Radio. And we are in the business of helping you reach your audience. And you have one. Serve it well. Helping you bring your message to life. Not just on a dead tree piece of paper. And then having perhaps a touch of immortality in that you have the opportunity to create things that could go on and serve people long after you have found your eternal rest in peace. And perhaps knowing that as you do these things, perhaps you're leaving a legacy of wisdom and help for others, just as those other men and women have done for me. Well, there's a lesson from my mentor, who I never met, who survived Pearl Harbor. And I hope, I thank you. I thank you for putting up with my story, but perhaps it has been an interesting idea that'll be useful for you too. All the best and blessings to you as we approach a time. Tomorrow, Hanukkah, we celebrate the Festival of Lights, a rescue story. Yes. A rescue story. And then we go on to the Christmas celebration, which of course is also a rescue story. Best and blessings. Bye for now.